for your body. We are members of the body of Christ. Jesus, you're the head of the church. Today we're here to hear your word, to receive it, to believe it, that we may be a doer of your word. You increase and we decrease. Have your way, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Something powerful is happening in this season with a prayer of agreement. And I've been taught on that on a few Wednesday nights. I don't know. That's why I love when we have people in our lives that God uses to help us be strong. Amen. We need one another. One of the greatest attempts from the enemy is to keep members of the body away from other members. Not necessarily that you need something from other members as much as they need you. Hallelujah. Bible tells us to come together and gather even more as the day approaches. Amen. Because of the division. All right, turn your Bibli, your Bible, to 1 Peter, chapter 5. I feel the presence of the Lord. Whew, God. And let's start at verse 6. Peter learned the hard way, you know, in his life. When you hear Peter say some things, it's because you've learned you shouldn't have said, done the opposite. So 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6 through verse 11 reads, "Therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. To him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever." Everybody say, amen. Let the church say, amen. So be it. Amen. There's so much in this passage, but what I felt today is that the Lord wanted to give us a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit, to help us walk in those very words. Because here it tells us that we have an adversary, and when it comes to spiritual warfare, I believe that the enemy was defeated on the cross. But he's so stupid, he doesn't get the message. So he keeps throwing fiery darts, and it's important to know what we need to do to come against the spirit of Antichrist, to come against the enemy. It's important for us because God is going to use you anywhere, everywhere that you are, because you're the members of the body of Christ. See, the spirit of Antichrist is that spirit that even says that Jesus didn't come in the flesh. Well, if we don't believe in the Trinity and we don't believe in the deity of Jesus, hallelujah. But it's also the spirit that comes against the body of Christ, because truly he's doing things through us like never before. So the spirit of Antichrist comes to really literally stop us because of the power we carry. Because greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. And that's why we need to know the power that's available to us, not just at a one time, but to be so filled. And Ephesians 5:18 tells us to be, he said, don't be drunk with wine wherein there's excess, but be filled. Be filled with the Spirit. Here it says, be sober. 7 times in the New Testament you see the words say, be sober, be sober, be sober. You're thinking, gee. First miracle was water into wine. I wonder how many of the extra barrels. Because he keeps saying, be sober, be sober, be sober. And often when you see that word sober, it's right before it says to be watchful, to be vigilant. So you start seeing even before you understand that this passage is really God is taking us from grace to glory. Ah. We have to understand that there's a battle in what we're going to be filled with. There's a battle going on because of everything that we go through in our lives that's connected to the cares. That's why it says, cast your care upon him. He teaches us to submit to him in order to be able to resist the enemy. You know how we can resist the enemy? We don't need to fight him or destroy him because he's already been destroyed. He just brings lies. We just need to know what he's after, what he's trying to do. And to resist him can only be done to the degree that we are filled with his word, with his truth, that we are able to know what the word says. Because to resist him literally means to stand, to withstand him, to stand against him. And to stand in opposition of what he tries to bring. Because of who he is. So for example, if he tried to come against the people in persecution with death, that he comes with killing, you stand declaring, I am born again, I walk in newness of life. You cast your care upon him because you're strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. So you withstand him. We know that the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So when he tries to come and to steal, you withstand him by doing the opposite of what he tries to do. So you give more of everything that you are. If he's stealing your finances, that's when you say, oh, I better give more. You withstand him, oh God, by doing the opposite of what he's trying to do against you. When he comes to kill and you stand in your newness of life, because we don't know who's going to be called to be a martyr. Jesus said, don't worry about those that can come and kill your flesh. And be more concerned about the ways that you can not have your eternal life. If you're born again and you have eternal life and you're walking in newness of life, you withstand the enemy, you resist him by casting your cares, submitting unto who you are in him, his word to your life, and you stand with exactly the opposite of the opposition. If he comes to destroy, then build something. If he comes to destroy this, you build over there. If the enemy is the accuser of the brethren, you come against gossip with everything that you are. If he comes to accuse, you stand in the truth that you are accepted in the beloved. That the enemy cannot persecute you. He cannot put you on trial and tell you all the wrong things that pertains to you, and you did this and you did that. Yeah. What an incredible life that comes when you resist him by saying, no, I'm accepted in the beloved. I am after the things of the Spirit. I am born again. There is no condemnation for those who are after the things of the Spirit. So you have absolutely no ears of mine that's paying attention to you. You stand against him with what the word says. Honey, you with the opposite, you resist him. He hates it when you do the opposite. He tries to get you to divide. And whatever he tried to come to divide people, you stand together even greater than before. Oh, he gets so mad. He's like, oh, I come to divide and now you're stronger? Yeah? Exactly. We're resisting you with the very opposite of what you bring. Oh, there's so much power in that because it helps you stand. But you can't if you're not filled. You have to be so filled with the word, with his truth. But more than anything, you have to receive the infilling that he has made available for you now without even doing anything, just to receive the power that comes from on high so that you can stand and withstand and be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. It's an interesting thing when you understand the comparison that they're making between being sober and being filled. Because when people go through cares, he says, cast your cares. When people go through things that they care about, the cares of the world for the children, how many knows we can stand for ourselves, but when it comes to our mates and our families and our children and our grandchildren, then we have to go back and understand this principle. No, I need to cast my care, even if my care pertains to somebody else. Because if I don't, then temptation will come for me to fill my care with the wrong thing. People who drink, and it says excess. So it doesn't mean you can't have a glass of wine. Don't look at me with that tone of voice. It says excess. There's a big difference between having one beer and two six-packs. The same way there's a difference between you having a plate of food and going back to the buffet 7 times and then try to find a doggy bag to put it in. There's a difference with the infilling. And where do you think people get so filled with the wrong thing? It's because of hurt, of pain. It's when people are filled with sorrow. They're filled with grief. They're filled with loneliness. They're filled with fear. They're filled to the point that they try to reach something to put inside of them so that they don't feel what they're filled with. So they take it in until they completely numb that pain. It's an incredible visual because it's true. When you minister to people and you know they're being filled with something, you have to understand that it's about the pain that they're trying they're trying to just numb the pain. So the more they can be filled with that. And the enemy is right there trying to lead people to reach forth and be filled with the wrong thing. That's why I'm so excited about what he's doing corporately, because we finally are in a point that instead of hiding things from people in church, we can walk in truth. Why? Because one of the things that the enemy does is he lies. So we resist him, we withstand him by walking in truth. Oh, he hates it. He hates integrity. He hates it when you share something in truth with a brother or sister. He wants you to keep it to yourself. I love it when people walk in truth. I think there's healing in just telling it like it is. And the greatest healing is that the enemy cannot come against you because you're standing in truth. So when he brings the lie and he hears you walk in truth, he's really upset. He's really upset. I love it when he's upset. I love it when he's upset. Hallelujah. I had gone out to eat at a restaurant a while back, and the waiter that came, you know, everywhere you go, you're trying to minister life. Enemy come to steal. Everywhere you go, you resist him by doing the opposite. You bring life. You speak life. And this waiter, I started engaging the conversation on how he had gotten there to wait tables. And you know, you always ask people, what purpose is God leading you to while you wait tables? Because I used to wait tables. So I just, you know, yeah, see? And because of the presence of the Lord that you carry, people will start unloading and just tell you things that you're thinking, phew. And maybe all you said is, hey, how you doing? Well, my husband left me, my wife, and you're just like, can you go get my salad and then come back? No. But this young man, he started saying, and he says, I don't remember the exact words, but it was basically, you know, he said, I opened the door. There's something that happened way back in my life that I keep on hearing a voice that lies to me about my wife cheating on me, and I see pictures of her, and I can't even be with her because I just see her, and you know, and he was really tormented and in fear, and I did a simple prayer, and I didn't rebuke it then. I wanted that to. Then he comes back, and I said, well, you know, you can be free from that right here, right now. So it doesn't matter where you open the door. He said, well, this morning when I was walking, I did receive the Lord completely in my heart because I can't live like that. I'm going to lose everything because of this warfare. And I'm telling you what, you're sitting at a restaurant. I didn't say come to church. I didn't say go to a church. This was a time that whatever he was filled with needed to be counteracted with what I was filled with. This was the time that there needed to be an overflow in the name of Jesus. I rebuked that spirit. That Antichrist spirit that has come to kill, steal, and destroy. I speak eternal life over your life. I speak life, freedom, deliverance. It was just so short and powerful. You don't need to pray 200 hours. Not everybody in the restaurant need to hear. You don't even have to be loud, you know. In the name. In the name. Of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And suddenly his whole countenance changed, and he started spitting stuff, and he's like, whoa. He said, what's that? I said, it's coming out. He had to take a small break to go to the bathroom. But there was total freedom. Why? Because I know the infilling of the Holy Spirit. I know that the Holy Spirit is always ready to bring forth the opposite of what the enemy is bringing upon people's lives. I believe that in all of you, God wants you to be so filled that the reason that you come to church is to receive this infilling. The reason that here, glory to glory, there's prayer through the laying on of hands is so that you can be filled. I think of being at a gas station. Well, this is a gas station in a way that you just need to be filled, because the things of the world come to just pull things out of you. How many people do you know that after they don't come to church for a few weeks, they start being empty and they start reaching for the wrong thing to fill themselves? Is anybody here? And it could be things, not necessarily wine, but it could be they fill themselves with TV. With games, with nonsense. Because they're looking for something that's going to help the sudden pain that they're starting, which really is a lack of the fullness. It's so important that you understand what you're carrying everywhere that you go. So important for you to know that in this season, without the power of God, listen, I don't have anything against books, I don't have anything against tapes, against anything. But if we're not filled with the power, if we're not filled with the power in ways that we have never before, how are we going to be able to stand against all those things that the enemy is and bring against us? How can we stand in the fact of the truth that we know? Only the truth that we know will set us free. If we're not filled with that truth, and any time the enemy tells us anything, we believe him. We have to know the difference between the voice of the enemy and the voice that we carry in our own head and the voice of God. We have to be able to know the difference, that when it comes to us, we stand against it with the opposite, that we can say, no, that's not what my God would say. It's not even what this voice sounds like, not just to him, but even to one another. It's good when people say, no, you have to stand and say, no, that's a lie, that's not even the way that it was even brought, that's a lie, I'm going to stand in truth. I'm going to stand in truth. Our children, our grandchildren need us not to talk to them too much about the problem. Do you know there's such an epidemic right now in schools? That's why we're increasing the youth nights, because people take their lunch break to have sex in the bathrooms. No, it's true. I could give you other things, but I don't want to talk about what the enemy does. I'm just saying, we have a whole generation. We have a generation that needs to know who they are, that needs to know their identity in Christ, and need to have us speak life over them, so that they can come against the lie that they don't matter and they don't have any identity, and they're looking for love in the wrong place at the wrong time. They'll try to be filled with love when God is love and all they need is God. When they need to hear about him and be filled with his life, we have to know how to cast our care upon him so that we can be effective in answering for others what's come against them. The more you feel, the more you're able to respond to things that come at you. You're able to let the divine identity that you carry respond to what comes against you. Well, when what comes against you tell you that you have no purpose, then the divine identity respond to that, because that's an antichrist thing that tell you have no purpose. When you have been created, you are His workmanship. That even God Himself said, I know the plans, I know the thoughts that I have towards you. It's a future, it's a hope. You are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. Good works. And really, that purpose doesn't have any power without you knowing that His presence and His power is with you. Because even God, if you would hear a purpose that He has for your life, you cannot even begin doing it without trusting that He will give you the power to do. If our purpose is to help others, it doesn't help us if we don't know that we're filled with His presence, filled with His power. And it's not just a few people. The head is filled. And if the head is filled with power, what does that say about a finger or a foot? If the head is filled, then the members start believing that they are in the Lord. And in the Lord, there's that presence, this power that in the Lord. If we start believing in that, then by faith, when we come together, we receive an infilling. When we're home and we need it, we receive it. It's difficult when you're by yourself because the enemy brings forth a whole bunch of nonsense. He brings forth the lies and we're not strong enough to withstand him with the truth. But when you come to church or when you call a brother or a sister, then he will bring the truth to you. He will bring the truth to you. People get filled with things, but it's not necessarily them that looking to be filled with the wrong thing. The world and the enemy and sin make sure that they're filled with the wrong thing. I remember when I got an encounter with the Holy Spirit for a whole week, I just wept. And I said, Father, what's going on? And he said, I'm emptying you. That I'm emptying you. I thought, okay, 5 minutes should do it. Said, I'm emptying you so I can feel you. And I will continue to feel you. So that when the house is left empty, 7 more come in. I know some people that have been set free from things, but they don't understand the principles of being filled. Filled with the word, filled with his presence, filled with the everything that's opposite to the enemy. The life, the restoration, the things that he brings. We need to be focused on our spirit man being filled. We cannot take care of our body first and our spirit last. We cannot take care of our soul and not take care of our spirit. We need to be filled to overflow. And we don't have to have great prayers and we don't have to just cry. No, because we're already in Him. So all we have to do is receive the more by faith. All throughout the day, I ask the Lord, more Lord, more Lord, more Lord, more Lord. Because everything that comes to you, try to literally just take that, take everything you receive to just take it away from you. The word that you receive, there's this great battle to come to try to steal it. You have to war with the word that you receive when you read your word. You have to war with every word of life that you receive. We know war. But this war has already been won. We're here to enforce what the Lord has done on Calvary for us. And we enforce it by speaking the truth. By standing, we enforce it by releasing forth the sword of the Spirit. We enforce it by knowing and trusting who we are in Him. And we enforce it every place that we go, that we put our foot down. We literally crush the enemy on his head. He has no power. The only thing that he's really concerned and afraid of is for the body to finally understand. Who they are and walk in authority to be filled with this anointing. He doesn't want that. He doesn't want that. So even if you hear it like this morning, then by the end of the day, I'll try to tell you, well, that's the pastor. No, it's not me. It's the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit. But it might take people through a time of emptiness that he will just allow you to just weep and remove some things. And at the beginning it was 1 week. Sometimes it could be 5 minutes after that. Sometimes it could be a night. Sometimes he'll show you based on what happened in your life. If you have the lust of a loved ones, then suddenly you start being filled with sorrow. And you need to just get a hold of some time alone with God. Yes. Sometimes you don't have to go to other places. I would even tell you to go to God first. Go to him first. Cast your care upon him. Allow the Holy Spirit to pick up that care so that you can be emptied of what you're filled with. Filled with sorrow, filled with fear, filled with grief, filled with the wrong thing. Cast it up, cast it out upon him. Because he cares for you. He's right there with his arms. He just wants to take people and he just wants to just love on you. The comfort of the Holy Spirit, the precious comforter. See, the Holy Spirit, in order to comfort you, he just brings his presence, the presence of the Lord, all in your life, and then he removes what has been filling you, and then he doesn't leave you like that. Isn't that a beautiful thing, that he would take what you filled with that you shouldn't be filled with, and then he replaces it with the opposite. So suddenly, instead of despair, you have hope. To be filled with him, this power is, it's not just the power to lay hands on the sick, even though it's that. But it's the power to be filled with hope instead of being filled with despair. It's the power to be filled with life instead of being filled with a fear of death. It's the power to be filled with his love so that you don't have to be filled with loneliness. It's the power of God that it's so totally supernatural that he fills you with his very life when you're born again. But he knows it's not enough. He knows the battle that you're in. He knows that you need to be filled. He says with spiritual songs, with hymns, with your brothers and sisters. It says to be filled everywhere you go. And really what he wants is the church, even where the corporate place of meeting, he wants that to be the place where people are filled. He wants that to be the place when you speak and sing psalms to one another, where you lift up, where you build instead of destroying, where you're there to just really speak life to upon one another. We gather together so we can be filled, so that we can be complete, perfect, established, strengthened. The literal Greek means to be a house that will not be taken by the wind. To be so rooted that no matter what comes your way, not only you withstand, but you know there's a difference between standing and almost falling. You know, you're just like, whoa, whoo, that was a close one. Whoa, I better just stop doing that. Yo, schlack. There's a big difference between standing like this and finally he said, after you suffered a while, he's talking in Peter is talking about persecution, talking about being persecuted for your faith, the spirit of Antichrist that comes against your faith, and he says after a while, he says you will be like that. immovable, steadfast. The winds come, the storms come, the things come, and what's in you, respond to it. What you don't even know you carry, greater is he who is in you. Respond to it. You start hearing out of your voice words you didn't even know you knew. You start hearing some scriptures you never memorized. The Holy Spirit start, that's the standard that he brings forth. You start standing so strong, you settled. Oh, Spirit of the living God, fill us in such a way that we won't even go like that. I don't even want to go like that. I want to stand like, I don't even want my hair to move. I just want to be so strong, so established. Hallelujah. From grace to glory, from grace to glory. The Peter say, now may the God of all grace. He say, listen, you're going to need my ability, my anointing. I've given you authority, but without the anointing, you can't do it. So he said, cast your cares upon me. Be sober. Don't be filled with the wrong thing. Cast it out so that you can watch. He says, be filled. Woo! Now, the greatest thing that I can tell you is that the Lord, and I know some people, more and more people are watching online, and I want to pray up here so they can be part of this prayer, because the Holy Spirit, you don't even have to be here to be here. And I know many people that are looking for churches like this church, and they're watching online, so they're part of our church. They're in California, hey, Florida, hey. It's a beautiful thing, hallelujah. So stand to your feet, because what's wonderful is that signs and wonders follow his word. So guess what's about to happen? Guess what's about to happen? The word says to be filled, to receive it by faith. And today, lift up your hands and say, Father, I believe it. Jesus is the head. We are the members. Power in the Lord. Strength in the Lord. Spirit of Antichrist, we release. The opposite, Christ, the hope of glory. Greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. Today we believe and we receive a great infilling of the Spirit of the living God. Holy Spirit, fall fresh on us. Hallelujah! Say it again. Say Holy Spirit, and then put your feet. You know, because it's your strength to stand. So be strong in your legs. Yeah. We're gonna say Holy Spirit, fill me. Holy Spirit, help me stand strong. I will not be moved. Steadfast, I will resist the enemy with the victory I have in you. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.